interesting and I would say almost provocative talk by my dear Guruji. In fact, I have worked with Mr. V.P. Raja when I was a scientist in Atomic Energy Commission in BARC, long time back, of course. And then to talk on new technology, which is not a very romantic and a very interesting subject, and to keep your interest alive for next 20 minutes is the second challenge that I have. But since the organizers have invited this trouble of inviting me to talk about this new technology, I'm going to be talking about some disturbing factors which are happening in the so-called R&D technology and new technologies regime. So much so that in one of the meetings of CII, there was a gentleman from, I don't know the name of the company, he said India does not have to do any R&D on the solar PV. Whatever is being done is done by us in the US. You only have to implement the projects and run these projects. That was, I would say, the gall of this guy to tell that there is nothing remaining to be done, and a shortened vision saying that everything on the PV, from whatever that is required, from gallium arsenide to the silicon to the cadmium to the film cells to the perovskites, and I'm going to be talking about some of these things, have been done. So you only implement the projects and run that. And he said that in a public forum. I was so much provoked in that particular meeting, and I had to really kind of take him head along. And it became one of the defining moments when the entire team of 300 people in the CII meeting applauded that India cannot, at this stage, a $3 trillion economy with so much of intellect, can reject or can neglect or can look at a technology which has to come from outside, and we'll do only the plumbing and wiring and cabling and connecting and be happy adding those 100 or 175 gigawatts is not going to give any kind of a complete value chain to the country. And that's the more point I want to really bring it. When we say why new technology and why we should develop, even if it means reinventing a wheel, because developing a technology and going to the entire rigmarole is extremely important. When I left Atomic Energy, where we were proud that we developed technologies because we were driven to the wall. They said, known technology will not be given. And we had a visionary leadership, I don't know the name, any one of them made us. I mean, we were fresh from colleges coming out, didn't know anything, and we built the science and built these technologies in nuclear energy and became self-reliant. When I joined NTPC, Mr. Rakesh is here, I was surprised when I was tracking what happened in the public sector was this very disease. I'm calling this disease not with any bad intention, that in 1947, when India won independence, we had no other option to get the technology from outside, because India didn't have that intellectual capital, neither had the time to run this capital. So probably in a social and a very different milieu that we have, we had to take the fertilizer technology, we had to take the power technology, we had to take the cement. Every technology, we had to be taking it and running it. 1947, there were enough reasons to do that. So what we got as our engineering education in those times, if you remember those HBTIs and Roorkees and all that, was only an education how to run, run the plants. So what we got was so-called know-how, and we didn't bother know why of any technology. I hope you understand here the difference between know-how and know-why. So what happened? When every technology developed, we ended up in only receiving the technology, whether it is right or wrong, impregnating them in the Indian ecosystem and running it. When I looked at the basic boiler design, when I joined NTPC, I was appalled at the way the design has been done and realized that combustion engineers from US in 1918 had designed this for a coal which is very different, without any mineral matter, and the same design has been imposed on the Indian system and saying that we don't know how to operate.
Our plant load factors are low. We do not have a proper understanding, whereas the basic problem was that we were adopting a technology which was not appropriate. Are you getting my point? We did not have, at that time, I agree, that time, whatever decision we took had a relevance. But when I hear that same statements made now, 65 years from there, then it literally, where are we leading? In this kind of a development where we seem to have, for whatever reason, submitted ourselves to the same thing which I've been saying that, no, we cannot afford to do that. So my dear friends, with that background, I'm going to be giving you, there's a huge opportunity. It is not an interesting subject, as you heard about the issues of governance, issue of efficiency in delivering services, issues with various other ethical and various things. But please understand, while those are all there, and I do not know, as Mr. Raja mentioned, that basic change of value systems in this country, where 1,000 years back we were so happy, we were saying that when India talked about sages, India talked about goodness, India talked about ethical, India talked about moral values, India talked about all this, Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, we did not realize that today we are ending up in such a situation. But while that could be one way to paint a bleak, gloomy picture, but there's a huge thing that we can do and we must do. For example, India's energy demands will grow. I'm making some obvious statements, so please pardon me because I need to connect this. Therefore, I'm putting a very obvious statements here. India needs huge amount of energy. And please, I don't know, sometimes people equate energy equal to electricity. It is not so. Energy is only 16.5%. We need energy in all forms. Today, industry, the commercial sector, the agriculture sector, the transport sector, you name them, requires energy anything but electricity. And hence, you need to look at this whole energy, and we know that India will demand more and more energy. For the simple reason that if you want to, in 20 years, to remain somewhere in the upper echelons of the Committee of Nations, India had to increase its energy demand, because there's a direct human development index linkage to the per capita consumption. I'm making a very obvious statement. So what I'm saying is that India needs more and more energy if it has to take a certain trajectory of development. Important. India has to secure its energy needs. I think this topic does not get adequate attention. I was in Washington about 3 weeks back when the Secretary of Energy, this MIT great professor, said, Dr. Sonde, we are so happy that United States, the United States, has secured its energy. Today, if there is a lot of things, if you are understand the geopolitical situations, notwithstanding the Iran deal, notwithstanding what is happening in the ISIS, you are realizing that one hydrofracturing technology, what US developed, has made this very fundamental change to US confidence of energy security, that they don't have to muddle themselves in this Middle East politics to ensure that they get their oil and gas. India is vulnerable. If I draw that complete model, we are terrorized that 20 years, if India is going to import one important thing outside electronics, is going to be oil and gas, and that's going to be detrimental in our growth species itself. Are you thinking about it? What are the solutions that we have to understand that India has to secure its energy needs? It's not energy independence, it is the security of energy. It's a far larger meaning, and I'm not here to talk about what is the exact implications of securing India's energy. Climate change. Again, climate change. I'm not talking about CO2 alone. At the micro level, I'll show some of the photographs of what happens in Delhi. I lived in Delhi for about 10 years, and those microclimatic burning of those straw fields creating a fog in the city. And today, the indoor air quality in Delhi is supposed to be one of the worst out of the 100 capital cities which has been mapped, shows that this development cannot be sustainable. China has realized it. China wanted to gallop and put from their 110 gigawatts to 450 gigawatts of coal-based power plants, ramping it to 1 billion tons of coal burning. Now they are realizing that this is creating a havoc to the citizenry of that particular country. And India is unfortunately following that particular path. So these three things, the climate change, the energy security, and a very high, fast growth of energy demand is creating a tremendous challenge on the India's energy scenario. As I said, India security, when you look at this whole availability of our primary resources, I have not included solar here, it is showing a very bleak picture. I put uranium, I put the closed cycle, everything what our friends in atomic energy are also telling, we still would not survive beyond 40 to 50 years. And 40 to 50 years, any planning of a country is too small a time in its development. So what options we have got now? I just could leave this particular podium with these options. What options we have got? One option, don't bother about all these things. Continue what we have been doing. That is business as usual. Continue. My dear friends, it is unsustainable. It is unsustainable. Because there is still not that, because these things do not get into a public debate. Because we are trying to handle known problems knowing that we have no solutions. But I'm saying that while those are issues, can we examine what is that we have to do if you want to reach those numbers? Import of new technology, as I said in my opening remarks, is simply disastrous. Today, we have got 2,454 gigawatts of solar power. 1,600 is coming from cadmium telluride, coming from First Solar in the U.S. U.S. Department of Energy has invested about $800 million in that particular company. India, through its feed-in tariff, is pumping almost $100 million because that particular cells which are brought in this is being paid by our utilities or whoever are created those independent power producers, and all of us are paying for a research done in the U.S. supplied by Department of Energy, and First Energy is laughing all the way getting onto those $1 billion. Let somebody challenge this statement. What are we doing about it? And when I go to the policymakers, they're saying, "Doctor, no, we cannot develop it. Let us get this technology." This is classical discussion what happened when I was in NTPC and discussing on the need for developing supercritical technologies versus Chinese. And I don't want to name them because some of them are here, that no, we have got the technology. India does not have to develop supercritical technologies. Same argument. And hence, I would feel that this is going to be disastrous. Because when you say manufacturing, when you say value chain, when you say human skills, when you say operation, when you say the whole entire thing that technology brings and has got such a domino effect, if you now ensure that I have to import technology, you get with only the know-how and you will not understand the know-how. Today, Kudamkulam plant, I think Mr. Raja will endorse, even a nut and bolt has come from Russia. I was talking to Dr. Kakodkar. He was saying, no, this is not the nuclear energy that we want. There may be many other compulsions. The PHWR that we have developed, I'm a part of the development. We are proud that not a single fellow can touch us. We can develop any amount of plants with a totally developed capacity. You know what efforts it went to make that technology and become India self-reliant in that? And if we can only follow some of those examples, I'm sure that we could reach this third option, new technology. And that's the focus of my subject. I have already consumed about 15 minutes. I've got about 7 or 8 minutes. I can go on telling you the landscape of what we can develop and what are the competencies, what we have done. I mean, I have done for the last 5 years in the renewable energy and the way that we can do, because there is enough intelligence and intellect available. If you are only able to get the act together, if you are only able to network together, if you are able to bring all of them together, put our manufacturing sector directly into this, I think
we can really get the ultimate true benefit of these new technologies, which is not simply putting 100 or 175 gigawatts, but a whole lot of things, which is meaning 600,000 crores or 6 lakh crores, which is supposed to be invested in the renewable energy, 580,000 crores will have to happen as an investment within the country. And that investment, my dear friends, had to be at the state of the art. I agree. That investment cannot be at a level which is subcritical, meaning that whatever technology that we develop need to have certain defining target moments. If I take a power plant, you know, power plant, the first Rankine cycle was built in 1918, about close to 100 years. And from there, the efficiency of that plant was 18%. And today, the plant efficiency is about 39%. So what we have done is just a 20%, a two times increase in the efficiency. I mean, 100 years, when the technology has galloped, if you look at the computing power, what my this iPhone has got, and sir, you remember what was our Bessem 6, a computer which was occupying an entire building, which has a power of 1/10 of this, shows that the technology has gone so much, whereas the energy technologies have not at all taken any kind of a offer. And that is the fundamental problem. And this is not an India problem alone of a high ash coal with a low calorific value. The issue is that we are actually not examining this because we are comfortable because some technology is there, some technology manufacturers are there, something has been done from 1947 onwards. Let us perpetuate because inefficiency is very convenient. Like the unhealthy food is always tasty, inefficiency is always convenient. We are not looking at actually what essentially required. And that particular thing, if you look at it, there are huge amount of new paradigms which are going to be defining. The fuel quality has gone down. The water requirement is going to be difficult. You know how much of plant load factor was lost. Our Raja Sahib will give me the numbers. Dr. Sonde, 200 million units were lost because there was no water to the power plant. You can't design a power plant with less water. The fuel contains 10% water. That water is creating inefficiency, and you are using external water, and you don't have water in your condenser, and therefore, you are not running, you are having a double whammy in the system. And that is, in my opinion, more criminal. We as a science and technology, then looking at some losses which are taking place in the transmission and distribution, at least those losses are used by some parallel economy in the country. Whereas here, it's the sheer incompetence, all of us, I included, of not able to address this issue of efficiency at the technical level, at the scientific level. Sorry, it's my not purpose to be provocative, but I'm trying to say that very often these points are remaining as a technology is known. Let's not talk about technology. We know everything. Because there are people, as he said, government is a vested interest. Even science has become a vested interest of executive committee of those vested interests. And hence, 80% efficiency. I'm giving you an example how you can reach 80, and I'm developing a plant right in Washim, not very far from here, 600 kilometers from here. We are developing an 80% efficiency. Forget about 18% efficiency. Forget about 30% efficiency. We need to hit these efficiency numbers very high, and that is where with a near zero emission, with a low water is what is required. So my dear friends, if I have to give a wish list, and I put some goals, there are 8 goals that I've put. I don't know how many goals I'll be able to really communicate. The organizers can raise their hand whenever you say the time is over, and I will close it. Yes, he says 2 minutes. I think noodles are out of circulation, I think. 2 minutes only you could do is cook a noodle. So 4 minutes, okay. I can double cook it now. Okay, so new power technologies, you are seeing new power generation, integrated waste to energy. My dear friends,
I've been knocking at the door. It went left to my chairman, I mean, earlier chairman's door also, that waste to energy should be considered as a renewable energy. Even now I'm making the statement for the Renewable Energy Act, which is, I think, on 12th of August, I've been called for a meeting, because there are a huge amount of things that you can do with the waste to energy. Integrated solar energy storage. Well, somebody talked about inefficiency of service. Look at the inefficiency. The plant load factors should be ideally 100%. I don't know how many of you agree. Plant load factor of every operating thermal power plant should be nothing less than 100%. The availability factor should be 100%. Plant load factor, leave it as per the demand curve. Here, when you see our, in Maharashtra, I have not done overall India because Maharashtra is supposed to be a kind of an elevated state, enlightened state, and we have got 54.84%. My dear friends, this is again another criminal act which we seem to be perpetuating on the public, the engineers, the technologists, I included. I'm not excluding it. Because that is something which is really creating, an asset is built, a power plant is built, and if you are not able to extract its 100% capacity, I would consider it nothing less than being dishonest with your own self. So you need to understand, before you talk about any new technologies, forget about solar. I mean, I'm very high on solar. My 80% of 24 hours go into solar. But I can tell you that these are very important. Myself and Dr. Kakodkar are writing a paper which will soon get published in many, because this is very important. Plant load factor, low water usage, and online efficiency. And my dear, today, with the way development has happened in the world of technology, these are very easily possible to be done. I can give you, I mean, here, what I'll do, a lot of goals I set forth. How to improve the efficiency of our power plants, of existing fleet of power plants. If I go through this, there are a number of technologies which we can do, and for want of time, these are all new technologies which can be integrated in the existing power plants, so that you can increase this plant load factor by double, which is what a power plant operator like NTPC are doing. We can just increase it by double, and that would mean automatic addition of capacity of your power plants. You don't have to add any new power plants, which cost you 7 to 8 crores per megawatt. This is as simple as that. But these technologies, my dear friends, are not that trivial. If I'm talking about even the earlier technology of what I'm saying here, of an online optimization, online robotic inspection, life extension, less water, these are all really the credible technologies that we need to develop. Then we can talk about goal two and new technologies, oxy-fuel, gasification, oxy-combustion technologies. I mean, this is something which I'm putting forth as the best, because tomorrow when we are going to say that our fuel is going to be less, we need to blend. Blending a fuel is like putting a blood A with the blood B and trying to ensure that your system works. Today, when I have to put all these municipal solid waste, biomass and everything, we need a different paradigm technologies and want to hit that 80% number. Carbon capture technologies. Waste to technologies, again, as I said, today, a lot of technologies are available. If I'm talking about this particular organic Rankine cycle, you can see that this organic Rankine cycle replacing water with organic molecule. Thermax, we are building a technology, and you will see that a half a megawatt over organic Rankine cycle will sit on this table. And if anyone of you have seen half a megawatt steam power plant, it will occupy this entire room. That is the magic of these new molecules. And this is something which I am in every forum. I mean, I traveled from Pune where Mr. Raja says that we are the most subsidy receiving district in the state. I traveled for the last 4.5 hours only to communicate that there is a host of technologies which we need to impregnate, some of them in the existing system, some of them in the new system, so that only after that you will find, and if you have got a mission mode approach, I quickly go through, I mean, you can just see this 125 kilowatt is like a small pipe piece. And this is set up by Thermax in a plant which is solar biomass hybridized plant. Well, waste to energy technologies, municipal solid, today the biotechnological intervention has taken us to a large number of places. Now, I think I must close it. So what I'll do, my favorite subject was renewable, and I'm not able to speak anything on that for want of time. What I will do is just, I'll zip through. There are top, I'm closing it, I'm sure. Pardon me? Four more minutes. Have you taken the permission of the audience to do that? Drop dead at that place and no issue on that. Let me giving a fresh lease of life for me to talk on renewable energy. I talk about the renewable energy requirements. Let me spend some time only on this and I may not show other things. What is the difference between a conventional fossil, which I spoke earlier, to a renewable energy? There are five differences. Energy, this is energy plantations and not power plants. Because when I see, even in the new Renewable Energy Act, I think many of you must have read it, I'm surprised that they got some coal-based power plant in their mind while drawing this, Electricity Act of 2003, and that seems to have been borrowed ad verbatim in creating this new act. My dear friends, all of you should read that new Renewable Energy Act. They call it as energy and go and talk every energy as power, electricity. And that's the first point I'm challenging them. I'm having a meeting with Tarun Kapoor to say, he said, what is this? I said, look, when you say energy, energy is not kilowatt hours. Energy is defined as oil equivalent globally. So first you have to define, change your definition. When you talk about renewable energy, it is not kilowatt hours. It has to be oil equivalent, and oil equivalent is the only term you can define energy. And it's a globally accepted practice. Because there is, when you change some act, certain mindset will be changed. If you are hanging on to the old one and trying to go into the new one, sure, you will never be able to reach that. You need to shed some of these old habits of understanding every energy as power, and therefore, they are all energy plantations. And they're harvesting. So you're close to kind of an agricultural practices, what India was known for. Renewable energy will become equal to an agricultural practice. Good or bad, I'm not here. But they will become a harvesting plantations and not a typical power plant which is shown as a chimney throwing, bellowing some smoke out of it. That is the change. That change has to be absorbed at the intellectual level and at the operational level, When you do that, the third point which comes, that God has distributed renewable energy. So you are not compelled at all that you have to generate renewable energy only in Gujarat, only in Maharashtra. It has, wherever it is there, it is available. Biomass is available, solar is available, wind is available, and geothermal is available. Waste is available. So you need to understand that now your plant is a distributed plant and it is not a power plant, it is an energy plant. If these two things are there, a lot of changes will happen in the way that we interpret this usage of energy, in the way we interpret the usage of energy. Renewable energy can multiple, the only thing that would require with the renewable energy is another big elephant in the room, which is storage. Because it is infirm, because it is dilute, because it is not so predictable, you need to have a buffer. And I've been suggesting that even before you go for a buffer, which is going to be hydrogen, which could be a battery, which could be a water storage, which could be a thermal storage, you can hybridize two renewable energies, or a fossil and a renewable energy. I'm a strong votary, and thanks to that, today NTPC is setting up a solar and a coal-based integration in Dadri plant. I had to move many mountains up to the highest political level to bring this concept, and don't put a silo of fossil and a silo of renewable and try to make them competing and trying to talk about the grid parity. These are non-starters. You need to have an overlapping, and that transition phase is what we are in, where fossil fuel will continue to remain. We need to clean them, we make them more efficient, we make them less water consuming, and integrate the renewable energy, light them up for next 20 years, and then fossil will come down and renewable will remain as the only form of energy. Professor Sukatme and I have written an article in Nature about in 2040, India can have 80% of its energy, not power, on renewable. Solar hydrogen is another big development. So that is the contours of this technology. So we are talking about how many minutes now? 1 minute? Okay, solar. This is exciting. This is the power of technology. And my dear friends, if there's a goosebumps on our body, the technology today can take us to any level. If only we understand that we don't assume technology what was true 40 years back. Today it has changed. The whole paradigms have changed. Today information is available to you like this. Today I must know what is happening in the solar PV as of yesterday evening. And I know it. So information is available. You can convert that into knowledge, and knowledge to wisdom, and wisdom to benefit of the society. This is what is important when you take this technological route in your development. Well, a lot of things we have done of indigenous development. This is that famous Shive project. This is another EU 10 million euro project. There is this cogeneration bagasse fired with the solar hybrid. There's a solar integrated cold storage. There's an air cooling system, one of the world's best. 54 countries have visited this triple effect vapor absorption system at Solar Energy Center, which is now called as NICE, developed by our group with about 10 institutions, India and abroad, collaborating with each other. Well, we are working with Indo-US program, a big program of Obama where $50 million, MIT, Stanford, NREL, Sandia, Oak Ridge, Thermax, IISC, we are working on very new concept of a Scott cycles, supercritical CO2 cycles. CO2, which is climate, if you are able to couple them and encase it, it can give you 50% efficiency. And that is the route for making solar power cheaper than the coal-based power plant without any subsidy. Mark my words on this. Supercritical CO2 cycles. There are some new development that you're doing. Fuel cell is another development. So my dear friends, so we need to look at, this is the last slide, is we are always here, very often. We want to do incremental things. We are happy with those incremental things. Most of the discussions in this quadrant, we have to look at this new technologies in new market, which is a disruptive innovation. When Narayan Murthy said that nothing happened in 60 years, I contest his statement. India has done great things. But you must be knowing that India's voice was throttled by the so-called Western interest. I will give an example of an ammonia processing system. Catalyst was developed by FCI, one of the best catalysts for the iron catalyst of reducing nitrogen and hydrogen to get that famous Haber's process. When Snapro Jetty wanted to set up a plant, they said that if this catalyst is used, we will withdraw the guarantee conditions. And we agreed. And that is what left to that great development. I mean, I can give you n number of examples. Do you believe a heavy water technology where a process which was developed, the entire 300-ton column went missing? It is still lying in Bay of Bengal. If I go on telling the stories, how much vested interest has stopped throttling, and maybe we willy-nilly agree to that kind of a force. And when this gentleman said that India need not have to develop a PV technology, whatever is required to be done is developed by the Western world in that way, Indian audience, was an ultimate breaking point. And I have taken that as a challenge, that India is capable only if you get our act right. My dear friends, having said this, I travel globally. These days I travel widely because we should think global. Today I connect with every development happening in the institutions and research and academic fraternity. We should be connected. But when you come back, develop your blueprints. Become the core technology holder. Get connected. This morning, Monash, one of the greatest university dean, was with me. Frieder Siebel, one of the fellows, came from University of California, from Los Angeles. He said, Dr. Sonde, we will work with Thermax because we are confident that this company will convert our IP into a technology which will ultimately go into the system. So I would like to be collaborating globally, but bring that ultimate benefit that it goes to the lowest common denominator in the country when the development happens. And therefore, I would always quote this Atharvaveda. We must learn to happily progress together or miserably perish together. Man can live individually, but can survive only collectively. That's the wisdom. Thank you very much.